Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that the day you would listen to his voice. Welcome to worship with Saint John Lutheran Church. I'm glad you could come out in the cold. That is, that your cars worked and all those sort of things that were necessary. Welcome to those who are watching on our video. This is the fifth Sunday after Epiphany. We are only a week and a half from the beginning of Lent, so we are quickly moving toward that Lenten season. But today we hear Jesus, hear stories of Jesus teaching and healing from Mark's Gospel. The slide should guide you through the service as usual. There is nothing unusual this morning. So I'll invite you to stand as you're able, and we'll begin with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God, you search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins, and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources, and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy. Amen. How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away, and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace. Amen. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Oh, that the day you would hearken to his voice. Harden not your hearts, as your forebears did in the wilderness. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of the word.
A reading from Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows upon them and they wither and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see, who created these? He who brings out the host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord. Let us read Psalm 147 responsively. Hallelujah! How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant it is to honor him with praise.
The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel.
He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds.
He counts the number of the stars and calls them all by their names.
Great is our Lord and mighty in power, but there is no limit to his wisdom.
The Lord lifts up the lowly, but casts the wicked to the ground.
Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music to our God upon the harp.
He covers the heavens with clouds and prepares rain for the earth.
He makes grass to grow upon the mountains and green plants to serve mankind.
He provides food for flocks and herds, for the young ravens when they cry.
He is not impressed by the might of a horse. He has no pleasure in the strength of a man.
But the Lord has pleasure in those who fear him, in those who await his gracious favor. Hallelujah.
A reading from 1 Corinthians. Paul writes, if I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew in order to win the Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord.
Please stand as you're able for the gospel acclamation. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. In the temple of the Lord, all are crying, glory. Alleluia. The servant of God took our infirmities and bore our diseases. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns so that I may proclaim the gospel there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So, in a few minutes, just a few minutes, it'll be 10 o'clock, and service will have come to an end. Those at home will close their browsers and go on to other things. Once worship service has come to an end, go in peace and serve the Lord. What comes next? What comes next for believers? In our gospel reading today, we see an example of what comes next. As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. So I think we've heard these readings so often, we come to them with some presuppositions, and we fill in blanks that aren't there, maybe inaccurately. So Jesus has just come out of the synagogue where there's been scripture reading and a homily and maybe song. It was the worship space for the Jewish people and the community they were in. And Mark writes, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew. Now, we know that sometimes Jesus invites himself to people's houses, like we hear in the Zacchaeus story, right? "I will eat lunch at your house, Zacchaeus. Come down out of the tree." But that was probably not the typical way things happened. It was probably more likely if they were going to the house of Simon and Andrew, Simon and Andrew had asked Jesus to come there. And notice in the story, there is at this point no indication that they brought Jesus to the house in order to heal Simon's mother-in-law. They invited Jesus home with them after worship. After worship, would you invite Jesus home? Would you invite Jesus into your house? Would you invite Jesus into your life beyond the 1 hour on Sunday morning? That's the first question that we pose to ourselves as we read this scripture. The inviting of Jesus into our home and our house and our lives. Now, we might be reluctant. You know, we don't want guests to come over to see all the dog fur in my house in the corner, or the dust on the shelves, or the dishes that didn't get done before you raced out this morning, or the spiritual matters that Jesus would see in our homes and our lives. We would be reluctant to let Jesus come in too closely. By the way, Jesus is already there. Would you invite Jesus into your home? I think believers want to say yes. And so the next question is, how do we do that? How do we invite Jesus into our homes and our houses and into our lives? Table prayers, bedtime prayers, prayer throughout the day. Scripture reading, and perhaps even scripture study, that you might meet Jesus, the Word. Service to those in the house, whether it's picking up after oneself or picking up after the other, or the phone call to the neighbor, or the letter to the friend, or the caring conversation, are all simple ways that we provide service to one another. Prayer and scripture reading and service bring Jesus home from the worship space into our houses, into our lives. Now, this is probably not a question I hope that believers ask, but why would we want to invite Jesus into our homes? Our scripture reading does provide an answer for that question, why we would want to invite Jesus in. So Simon and Andrew have invited Jesus to come to their house for Sunday brunch. Well, it would have been Saturday because it was the Sabbath day. And upon entering, presumably, Simon Peter's wife, who isn't mentioned in the story, begins to provide hostess services for them. But Mark says, now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. It's as if Jesus came in and said, is someone missing? Is someone not well? Is something not right in the house? Jesus knows. Jesus knows. And so they tell him about her. And Mark continues, he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and the fever left her. When Jesus enters our house, our home, our lives, there is healing. There is healing. Now, in this dramatic story, Simon's mother-in-law is healed. The fever leaves her. She seems to spring up out of bed immediately. And we hear other healing stories like that in the scriptures. What happens when we don't receive the healing that we desire, that we've prayed for, that we want? That disease, that diagnosis, that trouble that doesn't seem to go away. What does it mean? Does it mean Jesus hasn't come home with us, hasn't entered into our lives? The assertion of Scripture is that when Jesus enters our lives, our houses, our homes, there is healing. But let me tell you a fact about the story that we don't often remember. And a fact about all the other healing stories that we hear in the scriptures. Let's take Lazarus, raised from the dead after a number of days, as an example. He died again. And Simon's mother-in-law eventually died. And all those people that Jesus laid hands on, relieving their leprosy or their palsy, also died. Simon Peter himself and his wife, we are told, were martyred for the faith. They died. Where then is this healing that we are told about? It is the healing of sin. It is the healing of our separation from God. It is a healing to eternal life. Too often, when we are troubled by the distresses of our bodies and our lives, we're like the man who's won the $10 million lottery, a free gift that has changed his entire life, who scolds the waitress because she didn't bring back the right change from his $5 breakfast. Do you get it? What a great gift we've received in Christ. That though we die, we shall live again. Though we are separated by God for all eternity, God comes to us through Christ, through grace, to bring us to eternal life. When Jesus enters our house, there is healing. Even if it's not in this temporary time, it is a healing for eternity. We want Jesus to enter our homes to receive that eternal healing. But there's one final question that we must pose for ourselves as we read this passage. For what are we healed? Be it a physical healing, be it a spiritual healing, for what reason are we healed? What difference does it make? Does it mean that I just get to go back to doing whatever I want to do? Our scripture is pretty clear again. This is how it's written in the translation we heard. Jesus came and took Simon's mother-in-law by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. Now, It's unfortunate, again, that we get a vision of this story in our head that may not be entirely accurate. And there's a scripture translation that goes like this for that last line. When the fever left her, she prepared a meal for them. Oh, she's risen just to do women's work. This is not an accurate translation. I'm just going to say that. That's not the accurate translation. For we are healed for service. The word there is service, to minister, a word related to deacon, to serve. We are healed in order to be of service to those around us in Jesus' name, to serve the Lord. In Romans chapter 12, the Apostle Paul writes about the new life we are to live in Christ. He writes thus, let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection, outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal, be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord. Then he goes on to provide more descriptions of what that means. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer, contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless, do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. We are healed in order that we might serve, to serve the Lord, to follow the example of Jesus. Jesus comes to serve, not to be served. Jesus says it very explicitly in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 20. Jesus called his disciples to him and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. It will not be so among you. But whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you must be your slave, just as the Son of Man came, not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. In these three verses, it's only been three verses, this story of the healing of Simon's mother-in-law. In these three verses, we see what the ransom Christ pays for us, what difference it makes. We invite Jesus into our lives, our homes, our houses, as we dedicate ourselves to some simple practices of prayer and scripture and service. And we invite him in order to receive the healing, the forgiveness of sins, the eternal life that comes to us through Jesus Christ. And we are healed so that we are empowered to be representatives of God, to serve the Lord in what we say and do. All of it hinges on the grace of God displayed in Jesus Christ. So when the worship service comes to an end today, after the go in peace and serve the Lord, will you invite Jesus home, into your house, into your life? Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
Please stand as you're able. The peace of Christ be with you always. God has made us God's people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. So I invite everyone to be seated who's not on the church council, and I'm going to read names in case you forgot in just a minute. The following people have been elected by the congregation to positions of leadership. We give thanks for their willingness to serve. In baptism, we are welcomed into the body of Christ and sent to share in the mission of God. We rejoice now that these brothers and sisters will lead us in our common life and our mutual mission as a congregation. So elected last week were Ted Grunt, president, David Moore, vice president, Kathy Severson, secretary, Tim Johnson, treasurer, Heidi Pennycook was reelected, and Jody Parson and Dale Stebbins were elected to congregation council. There are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Council members, you have been elected to positions of leadership and trust in this congregation. You are to see that the words and deeds of this household of faith bear witness to God, who gathers us into one together with the whole church. You are to seek to involve all members of this congregation in worship, learning, witness, service, and support, so that the mission of Christ is carried out in this congregation, in the wider church, in this community, and in the whole world. You are to be faithful in your specific area of serving, that the Spirit who empowers you may be glorified. You are to be examples of faith active in love, fostering peace, harmony, and mutual understanding in this congregation. On behalf of your sisters and brothers in Christ, I ask you, will you accept and faithfully carry out the duties of the offices to which you have been elected? If so, answer together, I will, and I ask God to help and guide me. I invite the assembly to stand as you're able. People of God, I ask you, will you support these, your elected leaders? And will you share in the mutual ministry that Christ has given to all who are baptized? We will, and we ask God to help us. I now declare you installed as officers and council members of this congregation. Almighty God, bless you and direct your days and your deeds in peace, that you may be faithful servants of Christ. Amen. Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For the church, for ministries of healing and wholeness, for hospital, hospice, and military chaplains, for those serving in prison ministry, for all who proclaim freedom and release in the name of Christ, for all the baptized and those with anniversaries this week, Amy Van Cleve, Laura Hopkins, Crystal Nails, Lindsay Woodbury, Jeffrey Meehan, Viva Moe, Levi Johnson, Catherine Rail, Felicia Gilstrap, Matthew Baumgartner, Karen Johnson, Jenna Johnson, Alexander Patterson, and Grant McDermott. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For creation, for insects in the grass, clouds in the mountaintops, for cattle and rainwater they drink, for the humility to take our place among all creatures of the earth, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For the nations, for all who lead in cities and towns, states and countries, for community organizers, school officials, and CEOs, for international health organizations that in times of trial, fear, or hopelessness, they find freedom in service to those most in need, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For all wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor, for those lacking supportive relationships, for those crushed by debt, for those struggling with chronic pain or other sickness, for those exhausted from overwork or stress, for all who cry out to you, especially Jody, Carlene, the family of Bev, Ruth, Kim, Penny, Larry, Jennifer, Mary Ellen, John, Ada, Terry, Judy, Jean, Carl, Lorraine, Virginia, Bill, Roseanne, Judy, Al, Lorenzo, Carol, Melanie, Dick, Jody, Chris, Wanda, Jessica, Janet, Annette, Lois, Karen, Patty, Jennifer. All those affected by COVID-19, and those who name now silently or aloud. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For this congregation, for outreach and social ministries centered here, for parish nurses and visitors, for ministries of companionship and support, for the young people in this place who open us to new understandings, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. In thanksgiving for the faithful departed, who are called by name and now rest from their labors, that their lives serve as witnesses to the goodness of God, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, both silent or spoken, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal Father, with your generous gifts, you have aroused this sacrifice of praise. Teach us to live and love more generously, that every creature may be stirred to bless your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear my plea of innocence, O Lord. Give heed to my cry. Listen to my prayer, which does not come from lying lips. Let my vindication come forth from your presence. Let your eyes be fixed on justice. Weigh my heart, summon me by night. Melt me down, you will find no impurity in me. I give no offense with my mouth as others do. I have heeded the words of your lips. Keep me as the apple of your eye. Hide me under the shadow of your wings, from the wicked who assault me, from the deadly enemies who surround me. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. Sharing our life, he lived among us to reveal your glory and love, that our darkness should give way to his own brilliant light. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. We praise you for the grace shown to your people in every age, the promise to Israel, the rescue from Egypt, the gift of the promised land, the words of the prophets, and at this end of all the ages, the gift of your Son, who proclaimed the good news in word and deed, and was obedient to your will, even to giving his life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Therefore, O God, with this bread and cup, we remember the life our Lord offered for us. And believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us the great and promised feast. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Send now, we pray, your Holy Spirit, that we who share in Christ's body and blood may live to the praise of your glory and receive our inheritance with all your saints in light. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Join our prayers with those of your servants of every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest, until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Beloved, here is bread and wine. Here is Jesus. Receive and be fed. Thanks be to God. Please be seated as we recite the Lamb of God. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. Grant us peace. Please stand as you're able. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall ever be in my mouth. Look upon him and be radiant, and let not your faces be ashamed. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. The righteous cry, and the Lord hears them, and delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted, and will save those whose spirits are crushed. Many are the troubles of the righteous, but the Lord will deliver him out of them all. He will keep safe all his bones. Not one of them shall be broken. The Lord ransoms the life of his servants, and none will be punished who trust in him. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. God of truth, we have seen with our eyes and touched with our hands the bread of life. Strengthen our faith, that we may grow in love for you and for each other, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Consult the yellow page for announcements. I think there is an announcement about Ash Wednesday services. If not, that will be in next week's yellow page announcements. Lori has a comment.
So I know in the past that we've done Super Bowl Sunday, and I think that that phrase is probably familiar to many of you. I did write a grant to the foundation for some matching funds for soup cans to be brought to church. I don't know how it became February. I don't know where my time goes. So it will be much like we've done in the past. We'll have a table in the narthex area, so like when the office hours are in, if you want to bring soup in, you can. There'll be a table there. We've not gotten the big barrel out yet, but we're hoping to do that soon. I also know that the grant was to end next week. Before Lent, Bond yesterday in our discussions about how did it become February. We can do it all through the month of February. It doesn't matter if it's Lent. Everybody needs soup and food and things. So yeah. We're hoping just to make that campaign happen through the end of the month. So share with your friends and neighbors, and hopefully we'll get something in the bulletin next week. Thank you.
That will be on our list. Also, there's a matching grant for support of the visitation pastor. There'll be some more details of that next week's writings as well. Couple of things got past us after the annual meeting, and now we're 7 days into February already. I'm not sure how that happened. So consult the yellow page. I'll be here for Bible study at noon tomorrow, and the other things that are listed there. A closing prayer before our dismissal. Stand watch over your family, O Lord, that we who depend entirely on your heavenly grace may always be protected in the mighty fortress of your love. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace. Be the light of Christ. Thanks be to God.